Good afternoon, and welcome to Our Saviours Lutheran Church for the celebration of hope and new life for Don Kirkeide. I ask you to please rise as you're able. Welcome, in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our brother Don, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. When we are baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. Now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Don. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Our first reading today comes from the Psalms. It's Psalm 23, and our tradition here at Our Saviours is on these sorts of services, we always read Psalm 23, and we read it as a congregation together. So Psalm 23 is printed in your program, and I ask you to please join me now in reading it. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Our next reading today comes from Isaiah, the 40th chapter, beginning with the 28th verse. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Here ends the reading. Our final reading today comes also from the Psalms, in Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. Here ends the readings.
I can't believe I have to wear these glasses. I printed it in 14 font and I still have to use my glasses. So first of all, I wanna thank everybody on behalf of the family for being here and actually celebrating my dad's life. As I thought about what to say in this message, I was thinking that I really never had this conversation with Dad, and I wondered why I hadn't, since he would have loved to hear what I have to say. So, as I speak here today, I'm going to address it to Dad. Dad, as I think about the 52 years with you and all the things that I remember about you, I keep on coming back to all the things that you taught and gave to our family. You taught me and many grandkids how to fish, and even though you were not a great fisherman, because everything that we caught was usually bullheads, I did know that it really was more about the time we spent fishing instead of what we caught. However, I still remember to this day how to skin a bullhead. Because of your love for fishing, I was grateful that we had the wonderful opportunity to go on a flying fishing trip with your brother Al and a friend of mine. Even though the time together in this trip was remarkable, I do remember you saying, "Holy suffering, we caught a lot of fish." And these are walleyes, not bullheads. You taught me how to throw a football and a baseball and how to swing a bat. You taught me the importance of determination and to never give up. Dad, you gave me your athletic ability, even though I think you could have beat me in a race or a boxing match even in your 60s. Dad, you taught me to be humble. You had a lot to brag about your athletic ability with your boxing career and track in high school. But you never really talked about it unless someone asked. You also taught us discipline. I'm not meaning scolding us with your bent finger, pointing at us. I'm meaning to be disciplined in everything that we do and that we needed to create our own future. And with this, you also taught us the importance of hard work and to take pride in what you did. This was shown through your own work, as you enjoyed it so much that it really became an art to you. Everybody around wanted you to lay their carpet because of the quality of your work you did. And to me, I think they also wanted to see the legendary way you slung carpet around. Whichever reason it was, you did lay carpet in almost every house in the area. And as a little boy, I did notice the enjoyment and pride you took in your job. So I was always eager to go with you on your carpet laying jobs and be your right-hand man. These are extra special times that I will never forget. Dad, you taught us the importance of family and that the time spent with the family and not the material things is really what mattered. We didn't have a lot growing up, but we had many wonderful memories and experiences. With the multiple softball games in the front yard, the family game nights, the cross-country skiing at Pleasant Valley, the drive to get ice cream in Burr on Sundays, to the Nerf wars at your young age of 73, and the many nights playing Ghost Comes Out at midnight around the house, until one unfortunate night when we had a rope tied between trees that you didn't realize was there. It was also important to you that we made family trips to the Black Hills, Itasca State Park, Fort Robinson, and numerous camping trips to Camden State Park. These times were special and has now carried over to our own families. You taught us about dedication by the over 45 years of carpet laying, getting your bachelor's degree in your 40s, 39 years of marriage, and also the years spent in the Navy dedicated to your country. You taught us how to drive, but in the same sense, how not to drive. You're not wanting to miss anything while you were driving made it for a difficult car rides, even though you would always say, "I have never been in a car accident." This really wasn't a claim to fame because I think people just knew to avoid you on the road. You taught me how to create and maintain relationships. Everyone seemed to love you, Dad. You teased and joked around with everyone, which made them feel at ease and comfortable. This teasing and joking around is how you showed them that you cared, and this is why they loved you so much. However, I did feel a little sorry for my sister's dates that they brought home for their first time. Like the time you sat on the steps cleaning your shotgun when they arrived, or another time when you said to them in a serious tone, "You're not the same one that was here yesterday." The jokes and teasing became even more prevalent when you got together with your siblings. I remember you giving your little brother a hard time about being the biggest sinner of the bunch, since he was a pastor and the only one that worked on Sundays. Pastor Levi, did he ever tell you that one? Even in his last days of your life, Dad, when the nurses came in and asked how you were feeling, you would say, "With my fingers." Or when his granddaughter asked, "What are you up to, Grandpa?" you would say, "Oh, about 6 feet." I can only hope to carry on your fun nature. However, I don't know if my daughters would approve. Dad, you taught us how to be unselfish and to give more than you get. This was evident in the hours you spent teaching Sunday school, helping with confirmation, or giving to others less fortunate than you. Dad, you gave us all so much support as well. You came to many of our kids' and grandkids' sporting events, even if they were a long ways away. You were our biggest fan. You also supported our own choices, even though sometimes knowing it was going to be a mistake, but you had trust that we would learn from it. When reflecting on this day, Dad, I believe the most important thing you gave me is your last name. You brought this name to Canby more than 60 years ago and built it to be a well-respected name in the community. You gave this to me untarnished and clean. Since Kirkeide is such a unique name, it is hard to go unnoticed. I'm so proud to carry on this name and give it to my own children. I can only hope that I can carry it as high as you did. Dad, we celebrate your life here today. Even though you will be missed, you will never be forgotten. Thanks, Dad, for all that you have taught us and gave us. I am forever grateful. So now, go and carpet the floors of heaven and then wear them out dancing. I love you, Dad.
Please, rise, Israel. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is the firstborn of the dead. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Our holy gospel today comes from the Gospel of St. John, the 14th chapter, beginning with the first verse. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Now Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. In our gospel today, Jesus is talking to the disciples, and in this speech that he gives to the disciples, he talks about life after death. And to be honest, it's actually a somewhat rare thing in the Bible, especially in the Gospels. Jesus talks about the kingdom of heaven quite a bit, but when it comes to talking about life after death, there isn't a lot. And there's not a lot that really describes it, except here. Jesus is speaking to the disciples, and he's giving them this incredible, incredible promise. He's giving them this promise that when the time comes, that his Father's house has many dwelling places, that there is this great, incredible place that he will go ahead and prepare for us. It's this amazing, amazing promise. Now, often when I read this gospel, what I get drawn to is after this promise. After Jesus makes this incredible promise to the disciples, it's their response. It's Thomas coming in. He hears this promise of a place for him, of a place created by a God who loves him, and his response is, but what if I mess this up? What if I get lost? And I'm drawn to that because that's such a human response, that fear that we're going to be lost, the fear that we're going to be deceived and take the wrong trail. And I often talk about that when we come to this particular gospel. But after hearing you guys tell stories last week, I realized there might be another reason that Thomas is a little bit worried here. It's not so much that he's worried that he's going to be lost or worried that he's going to be deceived. Maybe Thomas is a little bit like Don. And he's just enjoying the journey and the people so much that he's worried he's going to walk right into a pole and not quite remember where he's going. Right? There's all sorts of reasons that human response of, oh no, what if we don't know the way? What I love about that is that Jesus doesn't dismiss this fear, but follows it up with more promise, telling them, you know the way because you know me. And when the time comes, I'll be there. I'll be there to take your hand and lead you home. Lead you home. It's an incredible promise. And when I was a kid and I heard this and this gospel and Jesus promising that in his Father's house there is many dwelling places, I remember thinking, oh, God has some sort of mansion in the sky. But the reality is it's so much more beautiful than that. Because a home is so much more than four walls and a roof. It's not so much a place as it is a state of being. Home is where you are welcomed. A home is where you feel safe. A home is where you are loved. A home, as we learned from Don, is a place where you can just let one rip really loud whenever someone comes over. Right? I have to say, I have never talked about farting in a sermon before, but if anyone was going to bring that out, I think it would be Don. Right? It's a place where you feel loved and safe and comfortable and happy and free. A place where you are loved. That's what a home is. And I think Don understood that. I think Don knew that truth, that feeling of love, and went out of his way to create that same feeling for all of us, for every single one of you who got to go and be a part of his home, his life. It's an incredible promise that God makes to the disciples. It's an incredible promise that God also made to Don. And it is a promise that God has made to all of us, that when the time comes, as it does for all of us, when we close our eyes for the last time, when we take our last breath, we can be sure and certain that God will be there, that God has made that promise to us. He will take our hand and lead us home. That promise is now a reality for the disciples. That promise is now a reality for Don. He is home. And though we mourn the loss of a wonderful man who brought joy to the lives of so many, we also rejoice that he is now home, at peace, peace beyond our understanding. Home in a place created for him by a God who loves him. And that one day, we'll take that same journey. And he will welcome us home. Amen. And now for a special music and video presentation.
You work on earth.
I ask you to please rise as you're able and join with me and the whole church as we confess our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Help us, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection to life everlasting. God of mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, we give you thanks, because by his death our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as the Lord's Prayer is prayed for us through song.
Okay. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in day our daily and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the
On behalf of the family, I would like to thank all of you for being here today. Directly following the service, we will be heading out to the cemetery for the burial and hope you can join us for that. I ask you to please rise as you're able for the commendation. And now, let us commend on to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Don. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Let us go forth in peace. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Marketplace is empty, no more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors, in the courtroom no debate. Work on earth is all suspended as the King comes through the gate. Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed. Broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he has freed. Little children and the aged, hand in hand stand all aglow. Who were crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow. I can hear the chariots rumble, I can see the marching throng, the fury of God's trumpets spell the end of sin and wrong. Regal robes are now unfolding, heaven's grandstands all in place. Heaven's choir is now assembled. Start to sing Amazing Grace. Oh, the King is coming. The King is coming. And I just heard the trumpet sounding. And now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming, praise God, he's coming for me. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming, and I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming, praise God, he's coming for me. Praise God, he's coming.